Stick to something you know about.
Listen, my daughter was about your age. Then she met a guy like you. Now she's dead.
You should believe in ghosts, P-Brain.
He's a closet!
Don't hurt me, please!
Don't keep me waiting for those onions, Herman!
This is all the whiskey you possess?
Everyone out of the way of the bulldozer!
Hello, and welcome to Hello, This is the Doomed Show. I am Richard. Folks, it's another solo episode, although you could say it's so low, because I'm involved. I promised, and I am delivering, part two of my horror movie reference books, cult film books talking. And sure enough, as I was making the list for this episode, I realized very quickly that there's going to be a part three. So I've already taken notes on part three as well. So there's definitely going to be a part three because this was a very long and involved process. Today, we're going to focus on the Giallo horror and Euro horror section of my bookshelves. So this will be of interest to all of you. But before I get to that, we have some feedback I want to read. Our pal Mark, friend of the show, contributor to this podcast, aka Deadly Enabler. Thanks, Mark. This is your fault. He wrote in and said some things about the horror movie reference book part one episode show talking. He says, Richard, the idea of doing two solo shows on reference and review books for horror films is an excellent one. You should do three. Okay, he didn't say that last part. I enjoy listening to the first show and I'm looking forward to the second. And third. He didn't say that. I started seeking out books on movies in the mid-1980s. These books encompassed all genres, but my strong interest in horror was already well underway at that time. Doubtless, one of the things that contributed to that interest was the fact that the library at my elementary school had a significant number of books on horror movies. These books included stills from the classic Universal monster movies as well as Hammer films. I remember looking at those photographs with wonder and fascination. From then until the late 1990s / very early 2000s, I purchased many books on movies, especially reference and review books on genre films, a few of which you mentioned on your show. Sadly, many of the independent bookstores that I was familiar with started to disappear in the latter half of the 1990s. The same can be said for independent music stores and video stores, as well as authentic ma and pa diners and restaurants. However, during that period, Borders and Barnes & Noble still had pretty amazing inventories of books, music, and movies. I'm really quite astonished when I think about all that I could find at either one of those chains. Of course, Borders is no more, and the selection one finds at Barnes & Noble in recent years is greatly diminished. I have kept only one book on genre movies from that time of collecting. It is the Overlook Film Encyclopedia. The edition that I have features The Bride of Frankenstein on its cover. It is a great book and a truly handsome one. Even though I disagree strongly with some of the reviews in its pages, the writing is very good, and the authors are knowledgeable and thoughtful. In recent years, I have purchased only a handful of reference books on genre movies. One is Stephen Thrower's amazing Nightmare USA. I also bought the excellent DVD Delirium Volumes 1 through 4. The other two are the wonderful Giallo Meltdown and Doomed Movie-thon, written by some remarkably talented and creative dude in Florida. Who is that? I will be keeping these books. They are awesome. Take care, Richard. I hope you are doing well. Best wishes, Mark. P.S. You mentioned something about video stores during your last show that made me think of Screaming in High Heels, the rise and fall of the Scream Queen era. Have you seen that documentary? Truthfully, it is one of my very favorite documentaries on genre movies. I adore Brink Stevens, Linnea Quigley, and Michelle Bauer, and I have a lot of affection for the many movies from the likes of David Ducoteau and Fred Olen Ray from the 1980s and early 1990s. Anyway, there's a very
interesting and succinct section in
Anyway, there's a very interesting and succinct section in Screaming High Heels that goes into the huge and negative impact that Blockbuster had on video stores and low to moderately budget filmmaking. It's good. Well, thank you, Mark. I appreciate your kind words, especially when you managed to plug what I was going to plug, which is Giallo Meltdown, a movie-thon diary, available now at Amazon.com. It's related to this content. I miss Borders. Borders was awesome. I did manage to clean up when they were closing, the one over here in Tampa. We got a lot of cool stuff. I got that Vincent Price box set, DVD set that I think MGM did. I got it for crazy discounted because they were just trying to move stuff out of there. I really miss a bookstore in St. Pete here. It's still there, but they moved. I have a bad feeling that their new location isn't going to be as great as the old one. It's called Wilson's. I really miss Wilson's. Wilson's was awesome. I picked up lots of my like 70s and early 80s horror books, like horror books about horror movies, that is. I totally forgot that DVD Delirium exists. Folks, if you can find DVD Delirium volumes 1 through 4, grab them, because I had them and then I sold them because, you know, I tend to sell things and then regret it later. But those are great books. I love them. And I will absolutely be checking out Screaming in High Heels, The Rise and Fall of the Scream Queen Era. I've been meaning to watch that, and I'm going to watch it. Folks, if you want to write in like Mark did, it's doomedmoviethon@gmail.com. Send me an email. I'll read it, or send me an MP3 and I'll play it. Yeah, we'd love to hear from you.
When it's good time party time, make it something really special. Stock up with plenty of Squirt and Diet Squirt, because both feel right at home wherever friends and fun mix. To get a great party going and make any get-together bubble, invite friends that mix well, like Squirt and Diet Squirt. Both super refreshers, both super party starters.
So let's get to talking about this subject. I have been collecting these frickin' books for years and years and years, and I've been gifted some great stuff from my wife and from friends. So, yeah, that's why these three episodes are so huge, because I have a lot of movies that are book-like, which are just books about movies, about books. Let's get started with the Giallo stuff. First and foremost, we'll talk about Profundo Argento by Alan Jones. This book is really funny to me. It's an excellent resource, especially when it came out. It was back before every single thing in the world was on the internet. And so I loved finding this book. It's funny because in the book, Alan Jones actually goes to the set of several Argento films as they're being made. And interviews whoever, you know, composer, cinematographer, and interviews Dario Argento himself or the cast. And he's very, very kind and praises everything he sees. And he discusses his excitement about being there. And then immediately the review of the movie is really negative and tears the movie apart. So I guess you get a fair and balanced review of the stuff from Mr. Jones. I kind of get a little bummed out by this one just because it's too negative. And I don't like opinions that are different than mine. So, a resource that for listeners of Hello, This is the Doom Show, you've heard us talk about this book many times. This book comes up, and I love when I can find some way to sneak it into the discussion. And this would be Spaghetti Nightmares, written by Luca Palmerini and Gaetano Mistretta, which I have right here. It's old as hell now. I would love to see an updated edition. This is from Phantasma Books. That's the book. I have it right here. I got it because I didn't want to write down the subtitle. The subtitle is Italian Fantasy Horrors as Seen Through the Eyes of Their Protagonists. This book rocks. It also sucks, but we'll talk about why it sucks in a minute. Why it rocks is the interview section. We've got Just to name a few, Claudio Argento, Dario Argento, Lamberto Bava, a.k.a. Lambava.
The Mo Lambava, Mo Betta.
Stefania Cassini, Mimsy Farmer, Lucio Fulci, Umberto Lenzi, Antonio Margheriti, Aristide Massacchesi, a.k.a. Joe D'Amato, Tom Savini, apparently he's Italian, Michele Soave, and even Terrence Stamp, who was in that frickin' Fellini movie. And good old David Warbeck. Now, those are great. This is a great, great resource for getting to know the people behind the camera. It's not very thorough, but it's pretty thorough. The whole book is only about 192 pages. So the interviews aren't super in-depth, but they're all really cool. Okay, so what sucks about this book? In the back of the book, there are capsule reviews, like one or two sentence reviews, sometimes a little more in-depth, of Giallo films, Italian horror, and like some Italian genre stuff. And it is loaded with spoilers. Loaded with spoilers. So be careful. Read these very gingerly. but the opinions are really funny. Usually they'll be like, this movie is this. Here's the entire plot. By the way, this sucks. It's really fun. I would recommend you getting this book and then using the back of the book as a way to find titles you've never heard of. But, you know, beware of spoilers. So that's essential. Love it. Of course, next is another book I have right in front of me here. See here, this one. I have to be careful because this one's been glued back together. Folks, I'll give you a few seconds to guess which one I'm talking about. Let's just say, over the years, all the pages have fallen out, and multiple times have I had to glue them back in. I'm talking, of course, about Blood and Black Lace, The Definitive Guide to Italian Sex and Horror Movies by Adrian Luther Smith. This is a Giallo Finder's Keeper's Bible right here. And like I said, this book is falling apart. It was not made very well. And I love this book. It is so good. It can be a little bit harsh, but I think it's more fair. It's open-minded. It's got Italian and Spanish Giallo movies hiding in here. And it's just incredible. Another one that needs an update. Even if folks are having trouble finding these, I'd like to see them reprinted. Even if like the author of Spaghetti Nightmares and the author of this one, that you're not interested in doing an expanded edition. I just like to see these back in print. This was a Dark Side magazine from the UK. This is one of their publications. I think this one's harder to get than Spaghetti Nightmares, but both are great. All right. Next up, we have Beyond Terror, The Films of Lucio Fulci by Stephen Thrower. There's going to be a lot more Stephen Thrower talking because Stephen Thrower is one of my favorite writers on genre cinema, period. I would love to just anything, whatever. Even if he did a book about comedies or like blockbuster movies, that would be great. But no, he is very much a brilliant dude. You've probably seen him show up on Jess Franco movie commentaries and Lucio Fulci movie extras. He's just great. But Beyond Terror is another book that I tore up, dude. I was like, I've already got the second edition, which is expanded. I think they found some more movies that were harder to locate before. And also he wanted to tell a very less than flattering story about when he actually met Fulci. But you'll find that pretty great. What else can I say about Beyond Terror? It also talks about the Italian film industry and how Fulci fits into it, which is really, really fascinating to me. Cannot stress enough. If you can track down Beyond Terror, either edition is great. Of course, you probably want the newer one because it's a longer book. It's also massive. It's a massive book. It's not as big as that Mario Bava book that Tim Lucas did, which I do not have because I'm not crazy. Brad is crazy. Brad has that one. When I visited him many years ago, I got to actually hold it, and I broke both my arms trying to lift it. So Lietta had to turn the pages for me, and she had to use one of those grabber things because even she's not strong enough to turn a page in that book. She's very strong, normally. So we went from Lucio Fulci. Let's get into some Dario Argento. Oh, we already started. Let's get back into Dario Argento. I'm talking, of course, about Fear, the autobiography of Dario Argento, which I really enjoyed. I got that recently and just blasted through it. It's very interesting. The only thing I didn't like was the farther he got into his filmography, the less detail-oriented he got with discussing the films. The first half of the book, like his personal life and how he got into filmmaking and the first, like, round of films up through, I'm going to go ahead and say, I don't know, I guess it's pretty detailed up through Suspiria, but then it starts to flag a little bit. I wanted more, which is, that's a compliment from me. If a book I've read leaves me wanting more, awesome. But yeah, and it's not very expensive, I don't think, so get that one. We're going to talk about La Dolce Morte from Michael J. Coven. Michael is spelled M-I-K-E-L. That's Michael J. K-O-V-E-N. This book, wow, is... this is not a book you can casually read. This is a book where you have to really set aside some time. It is extremely critical, analytical, amazing book. You'll need like to have a glossary of terms that you make up yourself, because he's very much into like the Filone, which if you've read any of these books, you kind of know about the Filone, which sounds like Filones. If you're looking for something academic, you will absolutely love La Dolce Morte. It's incredible. And there's only one other book on here that I think is that cerebral, kind of. We'll talk about that one a little bit. You'll never see me write a book like La Dolce Morte. I can't even friggin' analyze my face. I don't know what I meant by that. Here's one I have not read yet. Lieta picked it up for me, and I just haven't gotten to it yet. It's called Giallo Cinema and Its Folktale Roots by Michael Sevastakis. I'm hoping I'm saying that right. The last name is Sevastakis, and that's a very good book, I think. I actually have no idea. I'm excited, though. Speaking of cerebral, here's the one I was thinking of. Back to Dario Argento. We got Broken Mirrors, Broken Minds, The Dark Dreams of Dario Argento by Maitland McDonough. She is incredible. She is a super, super smart person, and this book is pretty dense. I think La Dolce Morte might be a little more dense. This could probably be more of a casual read, but not much. And she really, really, really analyzes Argento's work and picks it apart. It's just really, really good. And I believe the second edition is easily available. So go ahead and grab it. One more. Nope. Oh, I lied. Two more Argento books. Jeez. My pal, James Gracie, wrote a great book on Dario Argento called Dario Argento. And it is yet another examination of his work. But James writes very accessibly, and he's very passionate, and it's just really good stuff. I love his take on frickin' Argento. Now, we got the man who has become one of the secret patron saints of this show, thanks to Jeffrey. I'm talking about Luigi Cozzi, or our cozy pal, Luigi Cozy Cozzi. He wrote a book called Giallo Argento, and it's available, I believe, through the Profondo store, the Profondo Rosso store, the one in Italy. It is in English, and it's very fun. And Luigi Cozzi, he worked on several Dario Argento movies, so he was the man on the scene. And he provides some good analysis, and he also talks about just working with the guy. It's cool. It is time to address the elephant in the room. The very angry elephant, talking, of course, about Italian horror by Jim Harper. Folks, if there was one man who inspired me to start reviewing movies, especially Italian horror movies, and write books about Italian horror movies, it's this guy, Jim Harper. His book starts with Suspiria. No, his book starts with Zombie, Lucio Fulci's Zombie, and then goes all the way through the 2000s, like the early 2000s of Italian horror. And the reason it's so inspiring is because Jim Harper is such a dick. It is so weird. I can find a few movies in the book that he does like, but primarily it was an exercise of hatred for him. He's very negative about films that I think are classics or just ones that are entertaining and fun. He just hates them because they're not good enough. And dude, it just riled me up. And I, to this day, I still look to it as a joke because it's just, I just disagree with him so wholeheartedly that it just made me wonder, why did he write a book about Italian horror? It's like he took it on because nobody else was doing it, but he was the wrong man for the job. And hey, it's well written. It's fine. I just don't like negative Nellies. I said it, darn it. Negative Nellies. Okay, this is something I just got. Lietta hooked me up with this trilogy of books, and I had a little time to flip through a couple of them, but I didn't get very in-depth. I'm talking about Italian Gothic Horror Films by Roberto Curti. And the first volume is 1957 to 1969. Second volume is 1970 to 1979. And last but not least, the third volume is 1980 to 1989. So he covers all kinds of stuff. He just, man, these are thorough, thorough books. Not only does he review the films, he gives history of the Italian film industry, which is, like I said, about Stephen Thrower book. It's just fascinating stuff to read. These books are really engaging. Like, they hit the ground running. So I suggest grabbing all three just based on what I've seen of them. I think you would do much worse by not buying them, bro. Okay. Let's see. What's next? Ah, yes. I got two volumes here. These are coffee table books. This is not analysis or anything, but these are just cool to flip through. I'm talking about Voluptuous Terrors, 120 Film Posters from Italy by G.H. James. I don't know about you, but I love Italian movie posters. Those are just gorgeous. And these are neat. There's nothing much to say about them other than they're made very nicely and they're pretty to look at. But sadly, I don't remember even an introduction. I think it's just images, but maybe he did a third volume. I'm not sure. Okay. Stephen Thrower back in this talking. Eyeball, Sex and Horror, Art and Exploitation. It's a book that's edited by Stephen Thrower. I don't know how easy this one is to get. Back in the day, I believe they used to do a magazine called Eyeball. And this is the collected writings about cinema from that magazine. I'm not sure all who's involved in it. I forgot to grab it off the shelf before I started recording. But Eyeball's really good. My only complaint is the text is super small. Like, I need a freaking magnifying glass because I'm getting old here. But the writing in the book is really good. There's probably writing in there about sallow and frickin' possession and the devils. Because that's what every European horror book has writings about. Just great stuff. Super smart analysis. Gets you list making. Speaking of list making, because you start reading these books and you keep the notepad or your electronic notepad called the ENP next to yourself, and you use your electronic writing pencil to write down titles of movies that you're reading about. And the book that I'm talking about inspired me to do just that. It's called Immoral Tales by Cathal Tohill, No idea if I have that right. And Pete Toombs. Immortal Tales is really cool. Goes through French and Spanish and Italian and maybe German? Sex and horror films. Emphasis on the sex and horror. I read about a lot of movies in that book I'll never watch. Just FYI. But it is an incredible resource for all things like Jess Franco and Jose Ramon Larraz. Other directors I can't think of off the top of my head. I believe Sam and Kat of Daughters of Darkness podcast, I believe they use Immortal Tales a lot, or they covered most of the movies on their show. So check out their podcast. I'm pretty sure they did Immortal Tales. Speaking of Pete Toombs, we're going to talk about frickin' Mondo Macabro. I just got this book. I remember...
I'm sort of foggy on the details.
I remember probably, getting this book from the library a long time ago. Good old interlibrary loan. Great resource. If you have your library, ask them if they have an interlibrary loan department and then get some of these books for you. Mondo Macabro by Pete Toombs is an awesome resource for Asian cinema. I believe it's got some Bollywood talking in there. Just Asian stuff in general. Malaysia and, God, I don't even know all the countries that are in there. Flipping through it when I bought it, I was like, oh yeah, I have read this before. But then I put it back on the shelf and I haven't looked at it again. I know it's good because Pete Toombs is quality. But honestly, I might not remember the book well enough to expound on it. I'm pretty sure that they talk about things like Dangerous Seductress and frickin' Lady Terminator. So that stuff's in there. Wonderful. Oh, we're getting down to the end of this episode. Wow. Who knew? Back to Stephen Thrower yet again. This guy. He wrote two books about Jess Franco, and I thought I would never have these. I thought they were going to be wildly expensive, which they are not cheap, but they were expensive right when they came out. And then they were sold out, and I was pretty sad because I'd missed out on these books. As to whether or not they're easily available at this time of recording, I do not know, but... I found the second volume. It's called Flowers of Perversion, The Delirious Cinema of Jess Franco. And it talks about his films from 1975 through till the end of his career when he passed away. And so basically, I just call it the porno years. Luckily, for people who are less interested in sex films, he did a lot of stuff that, while it might have an erotic or sexy edge to it, it was not straight up, X or triple X pornos. They were movies. He even did some movies that were very much, mainstream-ish, like spy movies and thrillers. It's very surprising. His career did a lot more stuff than you think. And I got that one first, thinking I would just have it just to have it. But here's what Stephen Thrower did that blew me away. It is a narrative book. It doesn't go by release date because Jess Franco's films are so weird. They get picked up, sit on a shelf for a long time, or they get released years after they were made. You know, strange stuff happens. So what he did was, he did it in a narrative way of when they were filmed, movie by movie as they were filmed, and then tells the story of his life along with this these reviews. And holy crap. He and Lena Romay, his wife of many years until she passed away, the story of how he stole her is amazing. Jess Franco was a frickin' badass wife-stealing dude, so it's crazy. It is such a fascinating story. Not, I don't mean to praise wife-stealers, but dude, I have to frickin' give it to Jess Franco. He was a very... interesting looking man. So, as much as I loved this second volume, even though I was not going to watch very many of the films I read about, to be perfectly honest. Folks, if you don't know, I've seen about 50 or 55, maybe more, Jess Franco films. And I'm not saying I've reached the point where I'll never watch any new ones again, but I need a break that I'm in, and I will continue taking a break until I'm ready. I'm always hoping for them to discover more of his horror films that aren't completely tinged with the sexy. Because as you know, I am neutered. 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 I was loving the second volume, and all of a sudden, somebody's like, volume one is back in an expanded edition, which was weird because volume one had just come out like a couple years ago. All of a sudden, there's this expanded edition, and volume one was on Amazon for $33, which is crazy cheap. Like, if you think that's a lot for a book, folks, here's how big it is. Look at how big this book is. I know you can't see me. This is a huge book, hundreds and hundreds of pages, and just, like, massive. These are books that, like, leave impressions on your body as you sit in bed and try to read them. I won't say which body part, but, you know, I let you choose where you want to rest your book, erotically or not. Wow, I'm really rambling. Thank you. I picked up Murderous Passions, the delirious cinema of Jess Franco. And holy shit, this book's even better than the first one because I'm actually more interested in his early work anyway. So, wow, good stuff. I can't stress enough how much I love Stephen Thrower's work, and I will continue to love Stephen Thrower's work. Okay, here's the last book we're going to talk about. This is a book by Kierla Janice. Sorry if I'm butchering your name. It's called A Violent Professional, The Films of Luciano Rossi. This is from Fab Press. It's very small, but it packs a wallop. It is a book just about our buddy Luciano Rossi. If you've seen a Giallo or two, you've probably seen this guy. If you've seen some Italian crime films, you've probably seen this guy. One of my favorite roles is he plays the cop that's in City of the Living Dead who reacts to the fireball that comes flying out of the floor. That's Luciano Rossi. So he had roles like that, real small roles. And then he had roles that are much bigger, like in Death Walks at Midnight, where he's very frightening in that movie. God, it's such a great movie. And he is a great man. He passed away pretty young. He had a lot of health problems. But what's fun about this book is that the author not only does, I don't know if it's a she or a he, Kierla here, but they also, so they review the movie, they review his performance in the movie, and they give a star rating and a heart rating. So stars indicate how good the film is, and hearts indicate how hot Luciano Rossi was in the movie. So if you're only interested in him, you can check out how sexy he is in each movie. It's freaking hilarious, but it's a very heartfelt tribute to the man who was very underappreciated in his time. But yeah, it's just a fantastic book. I keep forgetting I have this one because it's so small. It just disappears in between other things, but I wanted to make sure I mentioned it.
Ooh. All right.
That's it. That's all I came to talk about on this episode. For part three, I'm going to get into horror movie books that are more recent purchases, like even some of them are even more recent than this. And they primarily focus on American horror films or British horror films. Wanted to get all the Euro stuff packed into one episode so you folks can be urologists. Yeah, I made that joke. Thank you for listening, and be sure to look out for part three of the horror movie reference books. Like I said at the beginning of the show, doomedmoviethon@gmail.com. I'd love to hear from you. If you guys can explain what Jim Harper's doing with that Italian horror book, you should write to me. And yeah, thanks again to Mark for that feedback. I love feedback. We don't hear enough from people. We've been doing this show for like a decade, and we get some feedback, but we don't get a lot. So we are always curious to see what you guys are thinking of the show, and more importantly, of my hairpiece. Does it look realistic? Bye, folks.
Hello, This Is the Doom Show is a proud member of the Legion Podcast Network. Please check out the other podcasts on legionpodcasts.com. If you'd like more Hello, This Is the Doom Show, go to hellodoomshow.podomatic.com or go to doomedmoviethon.com for the archives. If that's still not enough, go to @doomedmoviethon on Twitter. You can write in to Hello, This Is the Doom Show. Use the email doomedmoviethon@gmail.com. Doom Show episodes are available on record and 8-track cassette.